Every summer, the heart of the Great Lakes is witness to an extraordinary cultural phenomenon. A bold international musical event where the world's most celebrated artists gather to perform chamber music. Their passion and artistry move us to collectively experience the fullest range and depth of emotion with every crescendo, turn of the page, and stroke of the bow. Chamber music at its best, fresh, dynamic, soul-stirring. The Great Lakes Chamber Music Festival, where great music comes to play. Welcome back for day three of the Great Lakes Chamber Music Festival. I'm Paul Watkins, the Artistic Director of the festival. We're at the halfway point of our virtual festival, and we hope that you'll spend your weekend with us, because we have so much more wonderful chamber music to share with you. We hope you've enjoyed the previous performances we've shared. Today, we present miniature music dramas featuring an amazing group of performers, including Shai Wosner, Misha Amory, the Brentano String Quartet, and our newest board member, renowned soprano, Christine Goerke. This performance was recorded at Merkin Hall in New York City. Each piece in tonight's program seems to me to vividly illustrate the ability of small chamber music forces to conjure up powerful dramatic scenarios. The driving intensity of Matthew Aucoin's Open the Gates and the full-blown operatic emotions in Respighi's Il Tramonto begin this concert with explosive energy. Before we jump into the music, it's my pleasure to reintroduce Samuel West, one of the UK's leading actors. He is going to read the Percy Bysshe Shelley poem, The Sunset, which, translated into Italian, forms the text of Il Tramonto.
There late was one within whose subtle being, as light and wind within some delicate cloud that fades amid the blue noon's burning sky, genius and death contended. None may know the sweetness of the joy which made his breath fail like the trances of the summer air, when with the lady of his love, who then first knew the unreserve of mingled being, he walked along the pathway of a field, which to the east a hoar wood shadowed o'er, but to the west was open to the sky. There now the sun had sunk, but lines of gold hung on the ashen clouds, and on the points of the far level grass and nodding flowers, and the old dandelion's hoary beard. And mingled with the shades of twilight lay on the brown, massy woods, and in the east the broad and burning moon lingeringly rose between the black trunks of the crowded trees, while the faint stars were gathering overhead. "Is it not strange, Isabel?" said the youth. "I never saw the sun. We will walk here tomorrow. Thou shalt look on it with me." That night the youth and lady mingled lay in love and sleep. But when the morning came, the lady found her lover dead and cold. Let none believe that God in mercy gave that stroke. The lady died not, nor grew wild, but year by year lived on. In truth, I think her gentleness and patience and sad smiles, and that she did not die, but lived to tend her aged father, were a kind of madness, if madness 'tis to be unlike the world. For but to see her were to read the tale woven by some subtlest bard to make hard hearts dissolve away in wisdom working grief. Her eyes were black and lustreless and wan, her eyelashes were worn away with tears, Her lips and cheeks were like things dead, so pale. Her hands were thin, and through their wandering veins and weak articulations might be seen day's ruddy light. The tomb of thy dead self, which one vexed ghost inhabits night and day, is all lost child that now remains of thee. Inheritor of more than earth can give, passionless calm and silence unreproved, whether the dead find, oh, not sleep, but rest, and are the uncomplaining things they seem, or live, or drop in the deep sea of love, or that like thine, mine epitaph were. Peace. This was the only moan she ever made.
Thank you.
The two Brahms songs we're about to hear are very close to my heart. When I was a young boy, I would often read through these pieces on the piano with my father playing the viola and my mother singing. The first song, Longing at Rest, is a poem by Friedrich Rückert, which describes a peaceful evening intertwining images of slumbering nature with more human feelings of yearning and longing. The second, the Cradle Song, is a paraphrase of a song by Lope de Vega by Emmanuel Geibel. It depicts Mary, the mother of Jesus, appearing to the angels to quiet the wind in the palm trees so her child can sleep.
Thank you.
Brahms kept a porcelain bust of Haydn in his bedroom, resting on a mantelpiece opposite his bed. I think that even today Haydn's influence on Brahms is underestimated, as is his skill as a musical dramatist. This early quartet, written in 1771, is alive with imagery of the hunt in the opening movement and contains an exquisitely operatic largo followed by a witty opera buffa-style finale.
Thank you. Thank you.
It's been a pleasure once again to present you with some glorious chamber music. We hope you will tune in tomorrow morning for the final Schaus performance, hosted by Schaus Institute director Philip Setzer. The performance features the Viano String Quartet, who will be playing Felix Mendelssohn's String Quartet in F minor, opus 80. Tomorrow evening, we will depart from our virtual program to present an outdoor, in-person performance of Sela, The Breath of the World by John Luther Adams, with 32 musicians from the Detroit Chamber Winds and Strings filling the quad at Cranbrook in Bloomfield Hills. Tickets, if they're still available, can be purchased on our website, www.greatlakeschambermusic.org. We hope to see some of you there. Finally, bringing you this virtual festival would not be possible without the generous support of our sponsors, benefactors, and audience members. These free concerts are our collective gift to the community. We encourage you to join us in supporting great chamber music by making a gift to the Great Lakes Chamber Music Festival yourself at our website, greatlakeschambermusic.org.